Love You to Death, Stan Kraychik Mystery, Book 2, Writer Grant Michaels, Publisher St. Martin's Press, New York, 1992, Narrator Eric Ost.
Chapter 18, Goodbye, Mr. Chocolate Chips. Early the next morning, before the shop was open for regular business, Liz Carlini arrived direct from her brief retreat at Elaine's studio. She was escorted by a hulk of solid but shapeless muscle that she introduced as her bodyguard. No name, just bodyguard. With opaque brown eyes and a tiny head stuck onto a thick neck that was broader even than his ears, he probably answered to Moose. Liz, however, looked radiant, especially for a recent widow. It made me wonder if perhaps I shouldn't try coming up with the lordly sums that Elaine charged for the royal treatment at his studios. Yet, despite the ultra-exclusive services Elaine offered, Liz wanted me to style her hair. I was flattered to be the touch of home in her life. For Prentice's memorial service, she said softly as I led her to the changing room. When is it? I asked. Today. This afternoon. So soon? I made the arrangements late Friday afternoon, right after I spoke with you here. But aren't the police still holding his body? It doesn't matter. There won't be a burial, even later. Prentice chose cremation, so rather than let it all drag on, until then, I want to settle everything as soon as possible. A perverse thought. Were Danny and Prentice lying near each other in the morgue? I said, sometimes it's better to let the mourning expend itself rather than hurry it or repress it. Liz sighed morosely. Not for me. I can't bear it. It's a nightmare, and I want it to end it now. Then I'm going away for a while and try and sort things out. Take your bodyguard along, I warned. It's all been arranged, she said knowingly. Since we were alone in the shop, I shampooed her myself. A rare privilege, usually reserved for special customers or special occasions. For Liz Carlini, the sudden death of her husband and her business partner certainly qualified as a special, if bleak, occasion. She asked, have you seen Rafik? Not for a few days, I replied as I worked up a mousy lather in her hair. I wondered why she was asking me about him. Did you know that the police are holding him for the two killings? I said. He couldn't have done it, Venos. I agree, I replied, but I recalled the potential violence that always seemed to dance around him, kind of like Branko's aura, too. How well do you know him, Liz? Danny's the one who knew him best, obviously. When I needed a driver, Danny brought him in and I hired him. It's too bad they wouldn't commit to each other. They made a nice couple. Rafik would probably like you, too. I smiled dryly. We already got to first base. My remark caused a familiar old voice to shriek inside my head, nearly piercing my eardrums from within. First base! It screamed. It was my Aunt Letty, grilling me as usual, in Grand Inquisition style. Stanislav Classic! He is Klemik you! Liz's voice brought me back to the conscious world. Are you going to help him then? She asked. I don't know how. It seems all I can offer him is my gut feeling, and I meant that literally. I rinsed Liz's hair and wrapped it in a towel. Then we headed to my station, where she settled herself in the styling chair. I'd already decided to do her hair in a way that would reflect tragic grief with understated flair. While she sat, I pressed my hands onto her shoulders and massaged her gently. That kind of reassuring touch can strengthen the bond between stylist and client. The muscles in her neck and shoulder were pliable and relaxed, so the time at Elaine's had been well spent. I sectioned her hair and began cutting. At one point, I glanced into the reflection of her eyes in the mirror, the strange medium by which stylist and client often communicate best. You're doing great, Liz, I said, intending to bolster her morale, but my very words of confidence seemed to unhinge her bravery, and she let out a loud gasp. I'm so frightened. I saw her fearful eyes looking back into mine through the mirror. All this trouble started when I found out I was pregnant, she said. Her words caused me to stall my scissors mid-snip, just short of cutting what we call in the trade a hole. That should make you happy, I said. It should have. Her eyes stared directly into the reflection of mine, and she held her head up proudly, refusing to break down. We were both delighted, of course. What's the trouble then? Princess Will, she shook her head as though trying to wake up from a bad dream. Then she began to explain the facts with a chilly clarity that neither grief nor fear could it cover. Liz Carlini did, after all, have an MBA. Despite my dear husband's limited vision, his board of directors had made some shrewd investments and acquisitions over the years. As a result, and almost without knowing it, Prentiss controlled a multinational fortune with Gladys Gardner's Industries. The name alone implied the dregs of smelting rather than delectable food items. Liz continued, though there's now a whole new level of wealth in this estate. At least, there's that, I answered, not too sympathetically. But I still don't see the problem, especially now that you'll have an heir. Liz Carlini's body responded with such intensity that her hair actually bristled. While I recombed it to relax it, she said, I miscarried last week. Then for the first time in all the recent horrors, she broke down and sobbed loudly. I stopped working on her hair and put my hands on her shoulders again. She explained through her tears, it happened right after Danny's death. I was working too hard with Lajardin, and then his dying just drove me over the edge. I feel as though it's my fault. It's nobody's fault, Liz. With all this bad luck, I feel like there's an evil spell on me. In the old days, they'd probably burn me or chop off my head. Not if they saw the artwork I'm creating with it. Liz giggled softly through her tears, and it helped her stop sobbing without further comment. I handed her a tissue. When she regained her composure, I continued with my brilliant creation. So now I'm back to square one, she said. But as Prentiss's wife, won't you get everything? I'm not the sole heir. That can only be a true Kingsley daughter. It sounded like a brand name. Liz continued, according to an ancient trust that the first Helen Kingsley set up, unless there's a Kingsley Harris, the estate is split between one heir and the trust. Only a direct blood descendant and a woman can inherit the entire estate. In the past, there was never a problem. So, Prentiss wasn't the sole heir to the estate either. Liz shook her head imperceptibly. Imperceptible, except to me, who froze my scissors at attention for a moment. She replied, since it was a male, Prentiss had to share the estate with the trust, which was just as well, since the trust is what helped the corporation grow. That explains why John Lowe did inherit from the estate, because he has no Kingsley blood in him. Right. The only way he could get at the money would be to marry a Kingsley daughter. Her voice wavered. Now, there can never be a Kingsley daughter. Ever. Because Prentiss is dead, I thought. Liz smiled. But John can still inherit a portion of the estate from a previous heir. Which is possible with Prentiss's will. Exactly, said Liz. No wonder that baby had meant so much. She, or he, was the meal ticket, the guaranteed reservation on the Kingsley gravy train. What happens now, I asked. Half the estate remains in trust, and the other half is distributed according to Prentiss's will. And that half goes to you. No, it goes to John and I together. I stifled my grammatical reflex for something more important. A potential showdown in Bon Bon City. But isn't that settled by the terms of the will? It should be, Venos. A share of millions is fine with me, but John wants my share too. He wants everything. He never got over having a rich brother. What can he do, though? The terms of the will are set. There's nothing he can do about it except... I trailed off, not quite able to add the last words. To kill you? Liz replied, it's not too late, Venos. With an estate this size, the will has to go into probate. The lengthy delay caused by that would give John time to get rid of me. Had she read my mind, then he can inherit it all. Probate, the very process that was supposed to prevent the bungling of a will, ironically caused more trouble than it prevented. Still, something didn't settle quite right with me. Surely some shrewd lawyer would have spotted the loophole years ago. Then again, perhaps it was just such loopholes that allowed people to gain vast amounts of wealth from the exercising of mere technicalities along with murder. One thing is certain, though, she said. You've been a real help to me through all of this. When everything is settled, I'll show you appreciation in a physical way. There's no need for that, Liz. It's nothing. I'll be rich. Seriously rich. In spite of that, if there's any way I can help, within seconds she replied, there is something. Sure, I said, a bit surprised at her quick response. What is it? Could you come to the memorial service this afternoon as my escort? You've been such a comfort already. You really validate my feelings. It sounded like I was good for free parking. I thought a moment. How far did I want to extend this arrangement, as Nicole had reminded me Liz was only a client, but now she was also a widow who was asking for my help. Like Branko, I could rescue a helpless maiden. It would be a simple matter, too, since it was my day off. Besides, whom else could she ask now? And she'd mentioned the possibility of remuneration for my assistance. I heard myself weighing this personal situation like a business contract. Was I doing a favor, or was I gaining points? Maybe I wasn't so different from an MBA or a cop. No trouble at all, I said after a moment. Tell me where and when, and she did. I finished my work, then helped her out of the styling chair. As she donned her winter coat, I got a chance to take in the whole picture of her, with the rosy glow courtesy of Elaine's ministrines, and with the sad, watery eyes caused by Prentice's death, and with the severe, almost sexless hairstyle. I'd just created Elizabeth Ann Carlini Kingsley looked the perfect yuppie widow in mourning. Her bodyguard reappeared to take her away just as Nicole came into the shop. She nodded a polite greeting to Liz and Moose, then just as quickly bade them farewell, so they left the shop. Darling, she said brightly, isn't it your day off? Nicole said, I'd be careful with her, Stanley. There's more to that woman than meets the eye. That's your female prejudice talking, Liz. Told me she intends to bestow a tidy honorarium for all my help and comforting words. Stanley, you are easy prey to the guileless of attractive women. Does that include you? Thank you for the compliment. The memorial service for Prentice Kingsley took place at an Episcopal church. It might have been a cathedral, actually, in the South End. The 200 or so people present barely filled the first few pews of the imposing nave. Apparently, a larger attendance had been anticipated since the show was taking place in the main church, complete with bells and smells, rather than in the smaller chapel. I would have expected a larger crowd, too, since Prentice Kingsley was the last blood of an old Boston line. Maybe the Brahmins were all basking in warmer climes. Liz and I were led to our places in the front pew. The sickly drone of a funeral pipe organ accompanied our walk down the main aisle of the church. Except for the backs of their heads, I couldn't identify who else was there, not without turning around and staring directly back into the congregation. From all the unfashionable clothing, though, I guessed that the Gladys Gardner assembly line had been shut down for the afternoon so that the workers could pay homage to their leader. Once we were seated, I noticed John Lowe and Mary Finney in the pew opposite the aisle from us. They looked our way and clearly recognized us, but instead of polite acknowledgement, Liz and I received blank stares. Again, I wondered, why are those two always together? As for the service, there was none of that stand and deliver testimonial stuff, where members of the congregation proudly share their personal impressions of the dead person. No sharing here, not for a bloodline Kingsley. The only worthy testimonial could come from the mouth of God's own deputy, the rector of a high Episcopal church. He gave an embarrassing homily about Prentice Kingsley's heroic life, then ended with some blather about the glories of death. At one point, my attention was absorbed by the meanderings of a small black fly along the intricate hand-carved details on the front rail of our pew. What did she care about any of this nonsense except to find her way out of the mahogany maze and the lingering clouds of incense? Throughout the service, Liz Carlini maintained her composure and displayed her grief with the same refinement that a beautiful and sophisticated First Lady might show after her husband's assassination. After the church service, we all went to the memorial reception, which was being held in the same Copley's Plaza ballroom, where La Jardin's gala celebration and first killing had taken place. A little more than a week ago, During the brief limousine ride to the hall, Liz told me she was planning to stay at the house in Abigail until the estate was settled. I commented, wouldn't someone else be better considering all that's happened out there recently? The place belongs to me now, and I have my bodyguard, she replied with a somewhat resentful glance at Moose. The Abigail police have offered their assistance to protect me, and I put a restraining order on John Lowe. He can't enter the town without my consent. Since the Boston police would do nothing to protect me, I accepted the best offer, which was in Abigail. The Boston police probably had a lot more serious problems than looking after a rich widow who claimed her brother-in-law wanted to kill her. Besides, they thought they had their killer in Rafik. When we arrived at the reception hall, Moose, Liz, and I waited inside the limousine and watched the others going in. When John Lowe and Mary Finney walked by, the sight of them caused Liz to grip my arm with fearful tension. She hated Danny so much, Liz said. I heard her say once that gay people are all sinners and should be punished or be put away. Liz gasped suddenly and paused to catch her breath. Sorry, she said after a few moments. I've never said anything like that to a gay person. I thought the truth is often breathtaking. We also saw Laurette Cole and her son Tobias going by on the crowd. Once everyone had gone inside, Liz and I joined them. There was plenty of food and liquor, and most of the crowd was eating hungrily. Their jobs at the factory probably didn't provide much in the way of personal satisfaction or fringe benefits, so this event was their chance to gorge and guzzle at company expense. So what if the boss was dead? For her part, Liz wanted nothing but a glass of water. No ice. Various people lined up to offer Liz their condolences. Among those in line was Laurette Cole with Tobias along beside her. I hadn't seen or spoken to Laurette since her release, and I was looking forward to her friendly hello. But before the line got up to Liz and me, I saw Mary Finney nab Laurette and begin talking sharply and insistently. Laurette looked down at the older woman defiantly, but remained silent. Mary Finney persisted in her attack until John Lowe finally arrived to halt the barrage of insults and lead her away from the line. He made no apology to Laurette, who'd remained stoic through it all. When it was Laurette's turn to speak to Liz, she was surprisingly cool to me, treating me almost like a stranger who'd been hired as Liz's escort. I suppose in a way I was. Laurette addressed Liz plainly without emotion and without the usual and intentional misnomer. Miss Carlini, I am sorry. Your husband and young Danny were both fine people. Meanwhile, Tobias tugged at my trousers. Uncle Stan, that lady said Ma was a prisoner. He pointed to Mary Finney, far away from the line now, but still standing with John Lowe, always with John Lowe. You mean a prisoner, Tobias? I looked askance at him. Had Mary Finney really said poisoner? Or had he imagined it? I wonder if all the horrible talk regarding Laurette's murder charge had branded its impression on his young little brain. Or was it something simpler and more familiar? Something that Tobias and I seemed to have in common. The tendency to imagine things that happened that really hadn't. Tobias turned to Laurette. Ma, didn't you say you killed him? In one swift, smooth motion, Laurette knelt down and grabbed Tobias's little arm. She shook it firmly and said, "Don't ever say those things, young man." Liz looked down at them, then back at me. "Fenos, can you take me out, please?" she asked. "Now you want to go already?" "Yes." I took Liz's arms and quickly led her back outside to the waiting limousine. Moose tagged right along with us. I let Liz into the car first, then held the door open for Moose. I was about to close the door on them when she asked with big, moist eyes, "Aren't you coming too? Would you mind if I stay? I want to talk to Laurette." "That's fine," she said, but her face looked sad. "If you need anything, Liz, call me." "Thank you for everything, Venos." I closed the heavy door and the limo pulled away with a quiet whoosh. The loudest sound was its spongy rubber tires crunching through the crusty snow along the edge of the street. I ran back inside to find Laurette and Tobias. I wanted to know what was troubling her and why she was being so cool to me. but they'd both vanished from the place. I tore outside again, just in time to see them getting into a cab. Lorit, wait! I called out, but the cab took off and they were gone. Again, I went back inside, this time in search of Mary Finney and John Lau. In my meanderings, though, through the guests, I overheard two people talking, apparently a married couple who'd met at Gladys Gardner's years ago. They'd remained faithful to the old guard and to each other ever since. To them, Prince Kingsley had represented the ideal corporate benefactor, doggedly following in the footsteps set by the Kingsley matriarchs. All women of godlike vision, so this was the kind of pure and holy sentiment felt by the workers of a candy company that nowadays used mostly cheap chemicals in their products. I finally found Mary Finney standing with John Lau. Like Tweedledum and Tweedledee, the two seemed inseparable, like partners of a peculiar marriage. I approached them from the side where they couldn't see me. Mary was devouring a large piece of ham. John was holding onto a big glass full of amber liquid with ice. I noticed that Mary had put on special makeup for the occasion. She painted herself like a grotesque porcelain doll, with a near white foundation accented by red rouge and lipstick. But she'd neglected her neck and under her chin, so her ghastly wrinkled face seemed to hover, disconnected from the rest of her body. I addressed them both loudly. They say a killer always returns to the scene of crime. Mary faced me with her powdery mask. What are you doing here? She asked. Instead of answering her, I asked John Lau. Who took your gun? Who told you that? I recall Mary looking for it in your desk when we were in your office. I figured you used it to kill Dan Dougherty and then your brother. You sent it to me like a gift, but it wasn't very convincing, Mr. Lau. John Lau spluttered. How dare you? It's called freedom of speech. You can't accuse someone just like that. The question is, are you planning to kill Liz too, so you won't have to contest your brother's will? Is that what she's been telling you? John Lau's eyes brightened suddenly, and he chuckled, then broke into merry laughter. My sister-in-law is a compulsive liar. She'll say anything, and you believe her like a fool. Mary added, you don't know what you're getting into. Just mind your own damn business. All I know is that if anything happens to Liz Carlini, both your asses are automatically fried. Mr. Lau, you really ought to take your share of the estate and shut up. Young man, you need psychiatric help. Hey, I was a certified counselor. John Law said to Mary Finney, let's go. And they left me standing in the big hall of happy, hungry mourners. Before leaving, I ate something too. Why not? Liz Carlini had spared no expense to supply grand cuisine to the minions in memory of her rich, dead husband. I left the Copley Plaza and headed home, but I was distracted and bothered by a recurrent vision in my mind of John Lau and Mary Finney and their chronic togetherness. It was the quality of that togetherness that nagged at me, the marriedness of it, as though they were two parts of a synergistic whole. Yet they weren't married, at least as far as I knew. Then I thought about Prentice Kingsley's will. How could I find out about that? What could I do for more information? When a fool flounders, the solution appears, and I found myself facing the old facade of the venerable Boston Public Library. I was in luck, too, since they were still open. I bounded up the Dartmouth Street stairs past two majestic granite lions and went into the building. I always use that entrance because it takes you into the old library, the real one, with its dark halls and misty gray light and the lingering odor of ancient deteriorating paper. Once inside the building, I was happily overcome by the sight of one of the grandest marble staircases ever designed and built by mortal man. Exquisite proportions, graceful lines and curves, varied textures in wood and marble, vast colored murals and lively window light that changed dramatically in angle and hue according to the season and time of day. All these were facets of a singular gem of architectural detail in the old library. Whenever I'm in there, no matter where else I'm headed, I always make one trip up and down that staircase. It's a brief and pleasant detour into another place and time. I'd heard that the library had access to one of those general databases of periodical information where anything that has ever appeared in a magazine or newspaper was cataloged and available, though a computer, perhaps a computer, would help me where human efforts had failed. I found my way to the office where the computer searches were requested. I pushed open the door to the small room and was greeted by the smell of stale cigarette smoke inside. Seated at a computer terminal behind the counter was the librarian, a burly, blonde lumberjack of a man in his early 40s. Numerous half-filled paper coffee cups littered his desk, along with a large earthenware bowl mounded high with cigarette butts and ash. He looked up from his computer screen with a disappointed frown.
"I'm about to go on break," he said.
"It's important," I replied. Annoyed huff.
"Fill in the form," he said, and pointed to a stack of pre-printed computer requests on the countertop.
I examined the form, which resembled a complex 12-step program in computer queries. I said, "Can't you just ask it to look up something for me?" He answered,
"You have to formulate your search strategy."
I paused and studied the form again.
Too many words. I gave him my helpless but eager look and said,
"I'm sure you're better at it than I am." But the ploy to soften him up didn't work.
"You fill in the form," he said, "and I'll run your search after my break."
He pushed himself away from his computer and stood up.
"Wait," I said. "I need this information in a hurry. If you can help me, I'll return the favor."
He eyed me suspiciously with his big Nordic blues.
"How?" "I'm a hairstylist at Snip Salons near the Ritz. I'll give you a free cut and style."
He approached me where I was standing at the counter. The name on his employee tag said Thor.
"If you're willing to barter," he said, "you must really need the data."
"I do."
Did I dare tell him it might be a matter of life and death?
He took a blank form from the pile.
"What do you need?"
"I need to find out what's in Prentice Kingsley's will."
He rolled his blue eyes up at me.
"We're not a legal database, and that would be confidential information anyway."
"I thought they printed that stuff in the newspaper after someone dies."
"Only after a will goes through probate."
I thought a moment.
"Then what about finding anything else published about the Kingsley family?"
He nodded, then printed the word Kingsley in compulsively neat letters on the search form, a sharp contrast to the pig pen he'd created on his computer desk.
"What else?" he asked.
"Just Kingsley. Isn't that enough?"
"You have to narrow it down or you'll get too much information,"
I replied.
"How can you have too much?
I want it all."
"Then you'll have to wait a couple of days. A set that large would have to be printed off-site and sent here."
"I can't wait that long."
"Then you have to streamline your search.
Give me more criteria."
I thought streamline meant less, not more.
"Not with computers," I thought another minute. I was already discovering that my internal Slavic data bank and the real-world electronic ones had little in common.
"Can you add John Lowe and Mary Finney to the search?"
"L-O-U-G-H?" he asked, spelling out the name. "Like rough?"
I nodded. "Good guess."
"Not a guess. I'm a search librarian.
We're good with names."
He added the two names to the search form, which now said Kingsley and Lolf, John or Finney, Mary.
"Dates?" he asked.
"Pardon me?"
I replied. "Were my personal needs so obvious?"
"You have to specify a range of dates. Otherwise, you'll get results from the beginning of time until today."
"That would be fine," I said eagerly. "I need the historical stuff, too." He reluctantly X'd out some boxes on the form, then turned it around toward me.
"Sign here, please," he said, and offered me the pen.
"Why?"
"It's a rule. Can't do a search without a signature."
"Do you need an ID, too?"
"Only if you're a student. Otherwise, just a signature."
So I signed the name Dan Dougherty. Thor took the form and set at the computer terminal. He typed in the request, scrutinized the line he typed, then gave a sadistic whack to the enter button.
"Give it a minute or so," he said.
"That's all?"
He nodded proudly. They got 5 Superbank X3s networked on this database. Makes an IBM look like a vending machine. What else is on there? Thor said. You name it, I'll find it. Ran a search on YMA Sumac this morning. The results put the guy in ecstasy. Thor chuckled. Amazing. What can give someone a kick? Just then his computer screen filled up with amber-colored text. Here we go, he said. Got a couple of good ones here, but mostly short stuff. It's all pretty old. Don't know how much it'll help you. How old? Thor studied the screen. 30-40 years. Shit, I thought. I wasn't even an egg or a sperm then. Still want it? He asked. Sure. He punched another button on his keyboard, and a small printer sprang to noisy life, buzzing and zinging the lines of text onto paper. When it finished, Thor removed the folded the paper into a neat pile and brought it to the counter. These are just abstracts of the original articles. The publications are quite old, so if you need the complete text, you'll have to try the microfilm archives. This will be a good start for me, I replied. There's usually a charge for non-students, he said as he handed me the little stack of computer printout. But this one's on the house. A lonesome little smile appeared on Thor's solemn face. Thanks, I said. I took out one of my business cards, scribbled the words Cut in Style by Vanos on the back, and handed it to him. Best to make an appointment first, I said. He took the card in his tobacco-stained fingers, read it, and said, This isn't necessary. I'm just doing my job. Besides, it was kind of fun. Suit yourself, I said, but I may need your help again sometime. Thor pushed my business card into his shirt pocket amongst the collection of pens and pencils crammed in there. I gathered the printout, said goodbye, and departed from the little office. No sooner was I out of there than I found a place to sit down and devour the new clues. I unfolded the sheets and placed the thin stack of paper in front of me. I could feel my heart pounding in anticipation, so I put both my hands on the papers, palms down, and said my mantra. When my heartbeat and breathing had returned to normal, I said quietly, Please, please, please give me an answer. Then I turned over the first page. As Thor had mentioned, most of the clips were from about 40 years ago. As I pored over the lines, I thought perhaps there was a great database god somewhere, since the first few abstracts gave me more answers than I'd expected. Kingsley will contested. The will of deceased Helen Kingsley, most recent matriarch of the Gladys Gardner Chocolate Company, has Boston attorneys testing and battling each other's wits. Kingsley's husband, Jack Lau, the flamboyant, handsome Brahmin son, contested his wife's will on the grounds that their daughter, Mary Kingsley Lau, who stands to inherit the entire estate according to the terms of the will, is not a bloodline descendant at all, but was adopted as an infant. A thorough investigation is underway. The facts tumbled around in my tired brain. All kinds of notions I'd had were being disproved in one small paragraph. Helen Kingsley hadn't died giving birth to her son Prentice, as Danny had told me, and Abigail. Not only that, she had an adopted daughter as well. Branko had been right about one thing. I believed too readily the lies people told me. I continued on to the next abstract. Adoption revealed. Federal court investigators declared Kingsley heiress Mary Kingsley Lau, nee Finney, ineligible to inherit the multi-million-dollar Kingsley estate from the late Helen Kingsley. Mary Finney was adopted in infancy by Helen Kingsley and her husband, society playboy Jack Lowe. According to the terms of the original Gladys Kingsley Trust, set up 3 generations ago, only a bloodline Kingsley daughter may inherit the estate in total. That information confirmed the first abstract with an additional, incredible detail. Mary Finney was the adopted daughter of Helen Kingsley. My heart was racing again as I read onward. Kingsley Estate distributed the distribution terms of the multi-million-dollar estate of the late Helen Kingsley were released today by executors of the Gladys Kingsley Trust. 16-year-old Prentice Kingsley, natural son of Helen Kingsley, and Jack Lau, receives a monthly allocation from the trust, and when he comes of age, acquires senior management privileges for the Gladys Gardner Chocolate Company.
In a turnaround decision, the courts determined that Helen Kingsley's widower, Jack Lau, who contested his wife's original will, and Kingsley's adopted daughter, Mary, who stood to inherit the entire estate according to Helen Kingsley's will, should both be denied any portion of the estate according to the terms of the Gladys Kingsley Trust. Jack Lau is appealing the decision. No wonder Mary Finney had despised Dan Dougherty. She'd been denied her inheritance, and now it was about to go to something less than human? At least in her dim vision, a gay man. I continued on. Son born to Kingsley widower, a strapping 11-pound boy, John, was born last week to Jack Lau, Boston society gentleman, and former husband of the late Helen Kingsley, and to his wife, Myra, Nee Gorbich. Lau appointed vice president. John Lau was recently appointed a senior vice president of the Gladys Gardner Chocolate Company. His brother, Prentice Kingsley, is president and chairman of the board. It was enough for now. I was armed with new facts and ready to act. I could barely wait to share the treasure I'd unearthed. Snips was close by, and it wasn't quite closing time, so Nikki would still be there. I jogged down Newberry Street all the way to the shop, clutching the computer paper like the Dead Sea Scrolls. I rushed into the shop, breathing heavily from my short run. Nicole was surprised to see me there and in such a state. "How was the funeral?" she asked. I hurried by her toward the back room, not even pausing as I exclaimed, "You won't believe what I just found. Come back as soon as you lock up." I zoomed into the back room and plopped heavily into a chair, not even bothering to take off my jacket. There was too much to do. I quickly called on Old Beau at the telephone company to get the street address for Mary Finney and John Lau. My friend gave me the information, and I offered him a free style in exchange. So much for Ma Bell's confidentiality clause. When Nicole joined me back there, I showed her what I'd discovered at the library. She seemed blasé. "What's the point?" she asked. "Nikki, don't you realize what all this means?" "No, darling." "It means Mary Finney and John Lau planned this whole thing together." "Stanley," she said after taking a deep pull of smoke, "you sound like a fool." "That seems to be my nickname lately," I poured as both a drink. At least now I understood the source of Mary Finney's foul disposition better. She was abandoned twice by two sets of parents, and then again by the legal system. "You're not forgiving her, are you? You almost sound like one of those born-again people." "No, doll. She's still despicable, but at least I know the reason now." I downed my bourbon in one gulp like a real man. I'd better call my friend Rico and see if I can borrow her car. "Why do you need a car?" "Mary Finney lives in Dorchester and John Lau lives in Forest Hills. There's no way I'm taking public transit out there." "Where are you going?" "To confront them both and make them confess." Sensing potential danger in my expedition, she said, "Do you know what you're doing?" "As usual, no." I called Ruko and happily discovered that she didn't need her car that night, so my plans could proceed immediately. Then I asked Nicole, "Can you drop by my place tonight and feed Sugar Baby?" I paused. "In case I don't get home?"
"What do you mean, don't get home?"
"There might be complications."
"Meaning?"
I shrugged.
"I don't know. Delays, troubles."
Nicole became stern. "Stanley, if you really believe those people are killers, then why are you going after them?"
"What else can I do? Brinko won't help. He's got one idea in his hand, and he refuses to see any other solution."
"He's right. The rest of us are wrong."
"Sounds like you. We all have stubborn moments, Dom."
"You and the lieutenant fight for an entirely different reason, not stubbornness. If you haven't figured that out, you're simply being stubborn."
"Nikki, I got no time for theoretical debate."
Nicole growled in a low, mocking rendition of machismo. "A man's gotta do what a man's gotta do." Then she extinguished her cigarette. "I will feed the cat, Stanley. Then I will remain at your apartment until you call me there or arrive in person.
How long will you be?"
"I don't know." "You have to give me a time, Stanley."
"Why?"
"So that I can call the lieutenant to go and save you if you're not home by then."
"Let's hope it doesn't come to that."
"I'll call him myself, if I need his help."
"It may be too late." Then let it be on his conscience. I'd better get going. I still have to leave, and Nicole got up and gave me a long hug. Why must you indulge in these heroics? She asked. I thought a few moments. I don't really know. Maybe it's just a free Rafik for a repeat performance on Valentine's Day. Who knows? Without the edge of danger to his lovemaking, perhaps he'll be just another ordinary mortal. What about the lieutenant? Are you trying to prove something to him, too? Maybe a little. What you do in the name of love. I'm not alone. I kissed her and left the shop. On the quiet walk uptown to Rico's place, I had some time to wonder why, in fact, I was so damn stubborn. People have often accused me of compulsive behavior, a neurotic need to have my life ordered into discrete bundles of tidiness and logic. Kind of like a computer. All I can say is, those people obviously haven't seen my housekeeping habits or analyzed my thought processes. I believe my stubbornness is part of my healthy Slavic tenacity, the ability to stand my ground in the face of adversity or to hang on to any passing flotsam and ride out the storm. If Branko thought the matter closed, and I didn't, what was left for me to do but to pursue things in my own way, wantonly provoking people, stirring up the stew of lies and facts and events until the truth finally rose to the surface like the scum that must be skimmed off.
A Gay Mysteries Audiobooks. I think it is easy to hate a label, but a face humanizes the word. So this effort is twofold: to offer comfort to those like myself that your world didn't end because you don't fit into the view of acceptable society on both sides, and in hopes of helping those with family that are LGBTQ, that it doesn't mean we are aliens from the child they once knew. Reassure them so they can maybe be supportive at the same time being true to their values.